Hi, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the DeepMind12 video series. Today, I'm excited to bring you the editor for DeepMind. Now, this is a free iPad app or PC or Mac application. You can download the iPad app from the App Store, and you can get the PC and Mac application by just Googling DeepMind12 Editor. It's just a lot easier than me giving you a whole long URL. So, what does it do? Well, basically, it takes what's living inside the box here, as far as all the parameters, and puts it up in full color, in Technicolor, right in front of you, so you can get a very good idea of what the parameters are set to in a particular preset. It's kind of like when Dorothy went to Oz, you know, the movies in black and white, until they go to Oz, and it's Technicolor, and it's beautiful. Anyway, let's look at it. First of all, you can see, of course, what I was playing with there at the introduction. There's tabs along the top here, and we'll go through those in a sec. But basically, there's this main overview page here where you can see a representation of pretty much everything that's going on inside the box. You've got you get an intermediate screen here where you can adjust things, and you know, it's quite easy to adjust. Now, when you're used to going into a menu and going left, right, up, down, left, right, up, down, this is really much more easy to get at the parameters. So you've got LFOs, your oscillators, oscillator 1 and 2, VCA, your filter here. Here's your filter with your settings. It's interestingly enough, if you work sort of a hybrid method where you actually move the faders on the product, you can see they move on the editor as well. So, you know, you can do a little bit of stuff with the knobs on the product, and you can also use the editor to get at the deeper functions without having to dive into menus. It's kind of handy that way. So anyway, you got your filter portamento. By the way, just quickly, the way I've got it hooked up is I've got the iPad and DeepMind hooked up via Wi-Fi. So I don't have any cables or anything on the iPad. It's just I could be sitting down on a couch, you know, sipping a cool beverage, and while the synthesizer is playing from a DAW or something like that, I can be playing with the parameters and changing the sound. I've also got a laptop here sending MIDI clock to this, so that, as you heard in the intro there, the drums and the arpeggiator were playing in sync. Anyway, so as we see in this overview page, you see a representation of those. Also, look at these envelopes. This is great because you can actually start to play with the envelopes in real time. Put a little release time on it, or you can play with it either with the graphic or you can play with the numerical, which is kind of cool. And you've got all three envelopes there, the VCA, VCF, and the mod envelope. And you've also got a full color modulation matrix here. So if you wanted to, say, take, let's see, the control, where is it, control sequencer, and map it to, say, filter or something like that, it's quite easy to do. You got nice big characters, and you can turn it up and go through it that way. So at the very bottom here, we have, this is visual only, visualization only at the bottom here, of the arpeggiator, the control sequencer, and the effects. It's, you know, you can't see it on the main shot, but you'll see it on the blow-up of the editor. There's a representation of the pattern that I was using on the arpeggiator, some values, and then the control sequencer. I don't have anything set in the control sequencer yet, but if I go to that tab and set a couple of values, you'll see that at the very bottom of the screen, the control sequencer shows those values and that. And then also, it also shows the effect, which is really exciting because I see that I've got a phaser, delay, flanger in this preset. The mix is set to whatever, and it's in insert mode. And if I go to another preset, the editor changes, and now I can see in that preset what its effects, control sequencer, filter, everything's set to. And it's a very, very handy tool. So let's go through the tabs. I've showed you the overview tab. Then we go to the preset manager here. This is good because you can see all of the banks and all of the presets in all their named glory. You can just scroll through them just as you're familiar with doing, and you can load them just double tap, etc. And there's two lanes here, and this allows you to basically copy from one bank to another. You know, say you go to bank H here and you take my demo preset there, and then you go to bank A here and you load one of the presets and you go copy. It'll copy it over. You can also create new banks in one of these sides and store, that is, offload your presets that you've made on the DeepMind itself onto your PC or your iPad and keep them there for later and then move them where you'd like to go. Next is the preset blender. This allows us to take up to four presets, and blend between them their parameter values, which is kind of exciting because I've got four already set up here. You can go diagonally, you can go up and down. It's kind of amazing, actually. You only use the effects from one preset at a time, and you set that by, you know, picking which one you go. Etc. Anyway, that's the preset blender. That's kind of cool for creating something you weren't expecting. Now, here we get into the effects. This is really exciting because let's go back to my preset here. And because I built in a set of all four, I used all four slots, and I picked from this lovely group here, all in full color. And if you've ever worked on the product, you know that going into the effects menu, it's a little bit sort of little dark and hard to figure out. But with this, like if I want to see the phaser, I can see it in full color, full size, and I can take parameters and adjust them how I like, you know, the phaser. Change the mix. Yeah, this is worth the price of admission for the whole thing for sure. And it's really easy to put different effects in different slots. Now I put in the T-Ray delay, which I kind of like because it does this. Anyway, that's the effects tab. Now the control sequencer. You probably remember from one of the earlier videos where I did a discussion of the control sequencer. Now I believe... Well, what we've done is we had just a moment ago, but I'll have to do it again. I'll map the control sequencer to something, because remember, you have to map the control sequencer to something in order for it to work. So I'll do something nice and easy like that, and then we'll pick some values. We'll hold it, turn it on, and then do some stuff. Now it's going to cycle, it's going to loop through these values. I'll turn down the effects here a little bit and get the sustain going. There we go. Go to the control sequencer. Now it's going to go through these values. Just for now, I'll bypass that. It's kind of cool because you can see how it's going. I'll speed it up a little bit here, make it 1/16. There we go. And you can leave some of them blank, and it leaves a little blank spot there. And if I were to store that preset, that control sequencer pattern would be stored with the preset. Moving on, the arpeggiator, you heard that at the beginning. Now you can see how there's a range of values here. Usually using an arpeggiator does something like this. It just has one value, and when you... it just does something like that. But now you've got these, you can actually see a lot more clearly the values, and now you can change the gate, the velocity of them, and the gate time of them. So now, and it's a lot more fun when you go into the user, because you load a user one, then you can start to affect it and hear the difference. See, as I'm going higher, the notes are getting louder. You have to make sure that you've got... actually, you can see that it's not turned on in the editor, but it is turned on in the synthesizer. Those two things got out of sync there, and if I turn it on again, then I can go... There we go. Anyway, it's a lot of fun. And again, all those values underneath that would normally take you a little bit of menu diving are here and exposed at the top. Finally, then you've got the settings set here. This is where you go into the global stuff and you set up the network session. Right now, this is my network session. And you got your routing of all your MIDI information and your miscellaneous stuff. That's just a little easier to get around. That way, you can just bounce back and forth and get things edited. So basically, that's what it is. Another nice thing about it is if I tickle this in the right way, I can get it to come up with the naming screen. There we go. And yeah, this just makes it way easier using a keyboard to name your presets. Anyway, that's it for the editor. It's really a lot of fun, and man, it's really opened up some creative avenues for me. Now, that's it for the editor part of this, but we're getting down to the last two videos of this series, and I was just going to say, if anybody has any ideas for topics that I haven't covered, or topics that you feel I didn't quite do justice, please leave information in the comments, and maybe your request will get into the next video. So, for now, it's Tom Lang. Thanks for watching.